Hi, I'm Yair, and I want to show you how we tackle the problem of making the REPL more useful for writing large statically typed programs. Many programmers love the REPL. It provides validation, useful feedback, it's an excellent learning tool, and in some cases, it even provides the program output, obviating the need to build a full application. But many real programmers don't often use the REPL, or even don't use it at all. In fact, some major programming languages like Go, Rust, and C++ don't offer a REPL, and until recently, Java and C# were also on that list. Why is that? We believe that partly it's because the REPL experience doesn't scale well when writing large programs. We have identified three main challenges in scaling the REPL: bandwidth, liveness, and availability. What do we mean by bandwidth? Here, we're looking at a faulty factorial implementation in a Python Jupyter notebook. The REPL only shows the expression's final result. When evaluating many small expressions, that's perfectly fine. But when writing larger pieces of code, the programmer would spend most of the time editing their functions and modules and wouldn't get much feedback from the REPL, which doesn't expose their code's inner workings anyway. For brevity, we won't show large pieces of code. We'll try to convey the ideas with small examples like this one, where the only thing we see is that the result is wrong. This is like trying to figure out the problem in a complex machine when you can only look at it through a peephole. What programmers often do in this situation is use a debugger, which is generally perceived as a frustrating experience. We can think of using the debugger as being able to move the tiny peephole. We can get more information, and eventually we might figure out what's going on, but it's not easy to see the full picture. Another mechanism people use is debug prints, which are also a clunky process. We want to show you how Lambda solves this problem. Let's start by familiarizing ourselves with Lambda's syntax. This is factorial implemented in Lambda. Like in Haskell or ML, functions are defined as equations, mapping to a value on the right-hand side without any return statements. And the function application is just the function and the argument separated by a space. The if statement's branches are preceded by small vertical lines, denoting that they are not always evaluated. Okay, now we can resume. The top line is the REPL. Note the gray rectangle under the REPL. This is its result annotation. But that's not the only result we see. We have annotations for all evaluated sub-expressions. The programmer can also browse between different invocation scopes of the same function. This replaces debug prints and invocations of the debugger. It's easier to spot the problem this way. Note that you don't always want to see your code cluttered by all these annotations. You can toggle them as you want. These annotations are our solution to the bandwidth problem. Instead of looking through a tiny peephole, we can see the complete picture. Now that the bandwidth issue is resolved, what do we mean by liveness? If you will look for the bug in this factorial function, you're going to have a hard time, because it doesn't have one. The REPL is simply showing the stale results from before the problem was fixed. This problem has a seemingly simple solution: live reloading. Reevaluate the expressions when the code changes. But this solution could be dangerous. We'll demonstrate this issue with Swift. While editing his program, the programmer makes a small mistake. With this one typo, he causes the launch nukes procedure to be accidentally fired. What can we do to avoid this problem? If the programming language makes a distinction between pure computations and actions, like Haskell does, then the IDE could automatically evaluate only the programmer's pure computations and require an explicit action from the user to execute effectful code. Let's see how this approach looks like in Lambdu. Here is a program performing actions, reading a file and writing its contents twice back into it. But unlike the calculations we've seen before, it's not executed. Execution of actions is only performed when explicitly invoked by the programmer. Note that when the programmer edits the program, the outdated results disappear. After having faced the bandwidth and liveness problems, let's resume to the remaining problem and explain what we mean by availability. Back in Swift, a programmer is implementing a factorial function. Stumbled, he wants to check something in the REPL. The REPL isn't available because the program has a syntax error, so the programmer goes to fix the problem. Note that in other languages like Python, the REPL would be available, but using the faulty module wouldn't be. When the syntax is okay, the compiler can tell us about other types of errors. To sum it up, the REPL is only available when there are no errors in the code. This is what we call the availability problem. We're going to demonstrate how it works in Lambdu. A programmer is implementing a factorial function. Stumbled, he wants to check something in the REPL. The type mismatch in factorial doesn't pose a problem. The REPL can even evaluate incomplete functions. Only when the evaluated branch has an error, a result isn't available. This covers availability. But how can Lambdu evaluate code in the face of syntax errors or type errors? Let's discuss syntax errors first. Lambdu is designed to solve the problem of syntax errors in a radical way, to erase them from existence. What does that mean? Lambdu is not a freeform text editor. It is a projectional code editor where the options offered to the coder simply don't include syntax errors. Now for type errors. Let's talk about this type error we saw before. A potato might be a good source for nutrition, but factorial expects a number. When typing a text literal into what should be a number, Lambdu inserts a fragment into the program, which represents the type mismatch. It is visualized by the red rectangle, accompanied by the type in the fragment and the expected type. It contains the type mismatch and allows type inference to still work everywhere else without type errors. So, availability is achieved by using projectional editing and localizing type errors. But this solution may introduce a new problem. We have departed from text editing, which is the way that programmers have been editing their programs for half a century. It is intuitive, predictable, and familiar to all. These advantages of text editing stem from one core principle. What you type is what you see, or WYSIWYS. Modern IDEs augment this basic interface with some enhancements, automatic code completions, automatic indentation, and more. These enhancements were carefully designed to retain the WYSIWYS feel. Traditionally, projectional editors deviated from the WYSIWYS principle. For example, let's see how writing factorial works in Alpha, a projectional editor for the AGDA language. Alpha requires us to enter the code from the outside in. In this case, we would need to remove the x before we can replace it with something else. Then, we have to choose the multiplication first, and only then do we fill in the two arguments. Not as straightforward as using a text editor. We're going to demonstrate coding the Fibonacci sequence in Lambdu. Before we do, let's just overview how it looks like in Haskell, a textual functional programming language which we also use to implement Lambdu. Fibonacci uses the iterate function to apply a step iteratively on a pair, resulting in an infinite list of pairs. We map over it to take the first item of each pair. In the REPL at the bottom, we use it with the take function to view the first 10 items of the Fibonacci sequence. Now, let's write the same in Lambdu. The REPL starts as a hole to be filled in. We start typing iterate. After 4 letters, it is already the first completion, and we also see it in green where the cursor will go when we choose it. Typing a curly brace will create a record at the green position. Typing any letter will now name the first field. Unlike Haskell, we use records rather than anonymous tuples. Hitting space will move to the field's value. Pressing 1 enters the number 1. Pressing comma adds another field. Note that like in text editing, the projected syntax consists of the text type to code it, including symbols such as curly braces and commas. We name the second field and press space, 0 to enter the number 0. Now let's look at the lambda function we have as the next argument. A lambda function was already filled in when we chose iterate, and its input and output types are inferred to match our initial value. In Lambdu, multiple parameters and a parameter record are the same thing, so the lambda is displayed as getting two parameters, prev and char. The dark rectangle under the hole within is its type annotation. Lambdu displays inferred types for holes. Now, by pressing space, we will move to this hole. Pressing space now will pick the first result, which is a record with the desired shape. Now we type char plus prev. It works like in text editing. How did it work? When filtering whole results with an alphanumeric search string and typing an operator, the current result is picked and the operator is applied at the appropriate position according to the operator's order of precedence. Typing alphanumeric characters after the operator set the search string at the hole at its other argument. We'll now press space to pick this result and move to the next hole. We'll type char and pick it with a space. What just happened to the lambda? It is now displayed with a lightweight syntax sugar, with an underlined lambda symbol and with the parameters underlined where they are used. But why did the lambda change to be displayed in this form? This is because of Lambdu's projectional syntactic sugar. Any code that matches the pattern gets displayed with the appropriate sugar, with the user interface still retaining all the editabilities of the unsugared syntax. When enabling type annotations, we see that we have a stream of pairs. When we enable evaluation, we see the value of the first pair. Why only the first one? Because Lambdu's streams are similar to Java's iterators. To see more values, we can fill an array with them. Pressing Shift Left goes to the parent expression. We'll make an array of the first pairs using the functions take and toArray. We start typing take. The stars inside the available transformations indicate where the transformed expression will go if we pick this transformation. We press space to pick the first one. We now type in 10. Now, we use Shift Left to mark the top level expression. We start typing array, and we pick the toArray function. The REPL's value annotation now displays this array of records as a table. We actually only want one value from each pair. We mark the usage of iterate and start typing map. We press space, and now we type car and choose it. In the value annotation of the REPL, we now see the first 10 items of the Fibonacci sequence. Without the annotations, the code is more clear. That's why they are optional. We'll now mark the expression for the infinite stream of Fibonacci numbers and extract it by pressing Command X. It is now a let item. We name it Fibonacci. We'll now use Command X again to move it to the outermost scope. To conclude, our solution to the user interface challenge is what you type is what you see. To sum it up, Lambda's solution to scaling the REPL experience is using sub-expressions annotations for bandwidth, live reloading of pure computations for liveness, and witty-wist projectional editing with localized type errors for availability. These are the concepts, but the devil is in the details. In Lambda, we try to not just demonstrate these ideas, but to create an actual useful implementation that embodies them. Lambda is an open source project that I am developing with Eyal Lotem. You can download Lambda and play with it right now.
But we don't recommend switching your production code to Lambda yet. The language is not yet feature complete, and collaboration or source control features have yet to be implemented. But we are working on getting there. If you share our dream and want to help us get there faster, we are looking for collaborators. We'll finish the video with a shout out to related interesting projects. Jonathan Edwards' manifestos and his presentations of subtext have convincingly argued that programming could and should become much better than it currently is. His presentations were our primary inspiration for making Lambda. Our distinction of pure computations and effects comes from Haskell, which is also one of our inspirations and the implementation language we use. The sub-expression results notation that we use was, to our knowledge, first used in Christopher Hancock's FlowGo 2. The notation is also well explained and motivated in Glenn C's Legible Mathematics essay. JetBrains MPS is a language workbench which also supports witty-wist projectional editing. Paul Giussano's Unison and Cyrus Omar and colleagues Hazel describe visions that are very similar to our own in a series of papers and excellent blog posts. For more links on projectional editors, see the table from the wiki of the No Syntax subreddit. That's it for now.